got goat milk for you and goat cheese.
Oh, I feel myself coming back right now. He keeps me in goat's milk. Hey, awesome.
I'm doing good.
Hey, everybody, guess what? We're at Daniel chapter 9.
Woo-hoo!
Now, last week we had the blizzard of 2015. Really? So, if you missed the message last week, please utilize the fact that we are online. Does everybody know that? I mean, I have people in East Africa watching this, so you guys can do it. And don't think, well, I'm out of sync now. No, chapter 8 is not connected to chapter 9, so to speak. So it's all good. So go back and watch that because it's awesome. And I had a few comments last week that a few people got lost in a couple of areas. So I'm not going to do a review on last week like Darren asked me to do. But I will say the dream of the beast that Daniel had, remember the bear, the lion, the leopard, the nondescript beast? Well, the leopard with the four heads. This is the Grecian Empire. Is everybody with me? And the four heads are the four generals that rose up and caused the four divisions after Alexander the Great's death. You with me? So last week in the ram and the goat, the ram is the Medo-Persian Empire and the goat is guess what? Grecian Empire. And the predominant horn on the goat is Alexander the Great. And when it's broke off, that's when he dies and four other horns sprout out. That's the four divisions of the four heads from the leopard. Anybody have any confusion there? I love prophecy. It's just wild. I mean, it's like hang on to the horn and let her buck. So I don't want anybody to get left behind. And the reason we had to go deep into that is because out of those four heads, and you'll see all of this in Revelation chapter 13, revisited. So it's, God doesn't say anything for nothing. It's always really good. And so we saw out of the four divisions, out of one of those divisions of the Grecian Empire came a foreshadow of the Antichrist. That would be a little a Antichrist. And that was Antiochus Epiphanes, who desecrated the temple in 175 BC. And then there was another foreshadowing of a future. That was a foreshadowing of a future event. So as we go through tonight, I've got to remind everybody, predictive prophecy heading into the future, inspired by the Holy Spirit. And when you get over here, it's fulfilled prophecy if it's been fulfilled and it becomes what? Say it loud. And then eschatology, say eschatology with me. That's prophecy. Somebody said it really good over there. That was really good. That's prophecy that deals just with the end times. So with that being said, here in chapter 9, the mystery of the 70 weeks of Daniel, we're going to see prophecy. I have prayed and prayed and prayed. Have you ever seen those books like Computers for Dummies? You know what I'm saying? This is the mystery of the 70 weeks of Daniel for dummies right here tonight. And we are not going to leave till we get it. So I said, Lord, help me here. And so he said, to break it up into three. It's the 1, 2, 3 of prophecy, history, and eschatology. So we're going to see a prophecy of the restoration period after Daniel's time, after the captivity, 70-year captivity. And then we're going to see a time from there to the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ when he is revealed as Messiah. And then the third division will be in the future. It's the last 7 years of the history of the age, or the 70th week of Daniel. So that's how we're going to bust it up. But I want to start out, I don't want anybody to be left behind. And that's what I've prayed about all week. Some of us, and there's a few other people in this room that have been studying this stuff for 35, 40 years. And so I don't want to start just spouting off dates and times and stuff. It gets crazy. So I want us to pray for understanding. Let's just bow our heads. Lord, we ask that you will open the eyes of our hearts tonight and open our eyes and our minds that we can write these things on the tablet of our heart and use them as a witness of how you show up and you show off, Lord, Let us get this. And we ask it in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, we might do that several times tonight. Can't get enough prayer. And some of you just pray without ceasing, okay? Because this is going to be a wild ride. I'm so excited about this. Nancy, Joe, and Denny were at my house one time. We were working on some fence. And I was so excited about the 70 weeks of Daniel that I couldn't hardly talk. So it's happening to me again. So if I get tongue-tied. But the Lord told me today, calm down. Don't do anything from the flesh or your own strength. Do it from the Spirit, because you've waited your whole life to teach this chapter. So thank you, Lord. Here we are. So my first section is going to be called A Search for Answers. And my reader is going to read verse 1 through 3.
I'm Anita.
Hi, Anita.
In the first year of Darius, son of Xerxes, a Mede by descent, who was made ruler over the Babylonian kingdom, in the first year of his reign, I, Daniel, understood from the scriptures, according to the word of the Lord given to Jeremiah, the prophet, that the desolation of Jerusalem would last 70 years. So I turned to the Lord God and pleaded with him in prayer and petition, in fasting and in sackcloth and ashes.
That's it. That's it. You're good. Thank you. Thank you. Sorry, I wasn't looking. I was looking down here because I want you to know, remember I said every good movie or every good book deals with flashbacks? Well, we flash back to present time. Now, this is the first year of Darius the Mede. You know, we'd done a flashback into Nebuchadnezzar's kingdom with Belshazzar. But now we're back here. This is about a year later than last week with the ram and the goat vision. But Daniel's concerned about the prophecy of Jeremiah. And let me tell you, we cannot go there because it's so huge and so awesome. But I will give you one verse, and I'm going to go there. You stay where you're at. And this is 25:11 of Jeremiah. He says, this whole country will become desolate wasteland, and these nations will serve the king of Babylon for, what? 70 years. But there's a lot more going on here than you know. Now back, I said we're in the 9th week. Actually, we're in the 10th week, because we had a message called Before the Journey, remember? And we kind of compared America with what's going on, with what was going on in Judah, as far as turning from God, as far as worshiping idols, as far as turning their society into a secular society, as far as making alliances with godless nations like Iran or China, or, you know, bringing it to nowadays. But if that was the icing on the cake, you got to know the cake was the fact that they had not followed and rested the land on the 70 sabbatical years. I don't know if you know what that means, but the land was supposed to be rested periodically. And they didn't do it. And so the land was kept from rest for 70 sabbatical years. And this happened during the 430 years of antiquity. But later, guess what? God rested it all right for 70 years, didn't he? He rested it during this time of captivity. So this was a forced time to bring them into submission and to rest the land. Now, if God was your accountant, let me tell you, you'd never get audited. He keeps track of things. So the 70 years was fulfilled during the time. Now, why would you need to know this? Because it connects to the 70 weeks that we're going to study tonight. You've got to know this was a violation of the law. Not just the sabbatical years, but the jubilees as well. So, the land set for 70 years during the captivity of the Judeans in foreign land. It all connects to this. Now, this next reading, I'm so excited that I'm not going to say your name because I want you to say it. I'm so excited that my reader is going to read. This section is so incredible. It's lengthy, So if you want to just close your eyes and listen to the words, it's the most incredible prayer, verse 4 through 19.
Hi, my name's Beth.
Hi, Beth.
This is powerful. Anyway,
it is powerful stuff.
Oh, boy. And I prayed to the Lord my God and confessed and said, "Alas, O Lord, the great and awesome God who keeps his covenant in loving kindness for those who love him and keep his commandments. We have sinned, committed iniquity, acted wickedly and rebelled, even turning aside from thy commandments and ordinances. Moreover, we have not listened to thy servants, the prophets, who spoke in thy name to our kings, our princes, our fathers, and all the people of the land. Righteousness belongs to thee, O Lord, but to us, open shame, as it is this day, to the men of Judah, the inhabitants of Jerusalem, and all of Israel, those who are nearby and those who are far away in all the countries to which thou hast driven them, because of their unfaithful deeds which they have committed against thee. Open shame belongs to us, O Lord, to our kings, our princes, and our fathers, because we have sinned against thee. To the Lord our God belong compassion and forgiveness, for we have rebelled against him. Nor have we obeyed the voice of the Lord our God to walk in his teachings with which he set before us through his servants, the prophets. Indeed, all Israel has transgressed thy law and turned aside, not obeying thy voice. So the curse has been poured out on us, along with the oath which is written in the law of Moses, the servant of God, for we have sinned against him. Thus he has confirmed his words which he had spoken against us and against our rulers who ruled us, to bring on us great calamity. For under the whole heaven there has not been done anything like what was done to Jerusalem. As it is written in the law of Moses, all this calamity has come on us. Yet we have not sought the favor of the Lord our God by turning from our iniquity and giving attention to thy truth. Therefore, the Lord has kept the calamity in store and brought it on us. For the Lord our God is righteous with respect to all his deeds which he has done, but we have not obeyed his voice. And now, O Lord, our God, we, who hast brought thy people out of the land of Egypt with a mighty hand and hast made a name for thyself, as it is this day, we have sinned, we have been wicked. O Lord, in accordance with all thy righteous acts, let now thine anger and thy wrath turn away from the city of Jerusalem, thy holy mountain, for because of our sins and the iniquities of our fathers, Jerusalem and thy people have become a reproach to all those around us. So now, our God, listen to the prayer of thy servant and to his supplications. And for thy sake, O Lord, let thy face shine on thy desolate sanctuary. O my God, incline thine ear and hear. Open thine eyes and see our desolations in the city which is called by thy name. For we are not presenting our supplications before thee on account of any merits of our own, but on account of thy great compassion. O Lord, hear. O Lord, forgive. O Lord, listen and take action for thine own sake. O my God, do not delay, because thy city and thy people are called by thy name.
Thank you. Prayer, petition, fasting, sackcloth and ashes. You know, this is the most humble prayer I can think of. It's just pure humility. And what is the opposite of humility? Pride. Proverbs says, pride, God opposes the proud and shows favor to the humble. It also says pride comes before fall. But so many people get the whole humility thing just messed up. You know, God doesn't want us going around with a hang down hound dog look. I almost messed that up. He doesn't want us going around like that. And he doesn't want us going around telling everybody how bad we are, how broken we are, how lacking we are. He doesn't want that. That's not a piece of humility. Humility is not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. And you can write that down and look at it every morning, because humility is something we pick up, just like the cross, every day. So humility is not thinking less of yourself. It's thinking of yourself less. Are you good? I stuck a few verses here that just blow my mind, because this is kind of a progression. But with humility comes wisdom. You know, Solomon, of all the things he could ask for wisdom. Do you want to be wise? Do you want to know what to say when the tough questions come? Do you want wisdom? Do you want to say things to where you're writing down what you're saying because you've never heard it before? It's God speaking through you. This is how it happens. And humility comes honor. Comes honor. But it comes from a right thinking of yourself, that God is God and you are not. And you're definitely not lording over anybody else. And that's where, but in humility, consider others better than yourselves. That's tough. Because we don't think of others better than us. Show true humility towards all men. And it means women too. This is gender friendly. It's mankind. But my favorite, 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 5. And I could teach on this for 6 weeks. But I had to pick this one. Clothe yourself with humility. Clothe yourself. It doesn't mean own the clothes. It doesn't mean somebody says, where's your humility? And you go, it's back home in the closet. Matter of fact, it's so far back in the closet, the moths have eaten holes in it. It says, clothe yourself in it. Put it on. Wear it around. And it's just like I mentioned earlier about picking up the cross every day. We have to pick up our humility and put it on. It doesn't mean you got to be a pushover, let me tell you. But it does mean you need right thinking. God is God, you are not. God is God, and you are not. And that comes, you know, I was talking to somebody about a week ago and said, yeah, we've been praying this prayer, 2 Chronicles 7:14, since the beginning of the year. We haven't had a service. We haven't read this together in 2015. And he said, well, maybe we should do that in our church. And I didn't want to say, duh. That would be kind of unhumble. But I think everybody should be praying this prayer. Daniel's prayer was this. And this was about this time, exactly. So let's just say it together again. And emphasize humble. Get radical on it. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and heal their land. Praise Him. Praise Him. My next reader is going to read the 77s.
I'm Willie, and I'm reading from the NIV. While I was speaking and praying, confessing my sin and the sin of my people Israel, and making my request to the Lord my God for His holy hill, while I was still in prayer, Gabriel, the man I had seen in the earlier vision, came to me in swift flight about the time of the evening sacrifice. He instructed me and said to me, Daniel, I have now come to give you insight and understanding. As soon as you begin to pray, a word went out, which I have come to tell you, for you are highly esteemed. Therefore, consider the word and understand the vision. 77s are decreed for your people and your holy city to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness, to bring an everlasting righteousness, to seal up vision and prophecy, and to anoint the most holy place. Know and understand this. From the time the word goes out to restore and rebuild Jerusalem until the Anointed One, the ruler, comes, there will be 7 sevens and 62 sevens. It will be rebuilt with streets and a trench, but in time of trouble. After the 62 sevens, the Anointed One will be put to death and will have nothing. The people of the ruler who will come destroy the city and the sanctuary. The end will come like a flood. War will continue until the end, and desolations have been decreed. He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7. In the middle of the 7, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering, and the temple he will set up, and at the temple he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out on him.
Awesome, isn't it? Once again, I feel the Spirit telling me that we need to pray. So let's just pray. Lord, give us understanding of this. Make it plain and clear that it can be something we can use as our witness, something that we can just incorporate into our walk, Lord. Make it apply to us. Lord, do what it takes to just make it digest in a way that we can make it come alive in our conversation as we go about our day. Lord, don't let this be something we study one night and we never look back and we forget. Lord, we ask this in your precious and holy name. Amen. Now, I want to tell you guys, if anybody... Hey, Joe, I thought you'd come up here and take my place. Lord's called me home. If anybody wants to come up and take a photograph of this, this is the time. Come right on up, take your smartphone or your dumb phone, and get it. It's okay. And those of you who've never been here, this is like a small group, so it's okay. People are milling around. Just get up like you're going to go get some tortilla chips and some of Nancy Joe's salsa and bring me a bowl on your way by. But I've been to many prophecy conferences and such to where a chart like this is thrown up and then it's taken away. And I'm going, I'm a visual learner. So I'm going to leave this up the remainder of the evening. Here comes the camera. Come on, anybody else want a picture of this? This is good. I worked on this hard. It really helps when you can go back. You can even send it to your computer and blow it up. You can print it off. We're in the technical age. Daniel says in the age where knowledge is increased and people will run to and fro looking for the truth in the scriptures. Amen? And we want to find the truth in this mystery of the 70 weeks. It's like paparazzi up here. Prophecy paparazzi. Say that 10 times. Hey, Jim, I was looking for you earlier. Good to see you. Okay, the meaning of the 70 weeks. And I almost feel like we need to pray again, but let's push forward. The meaning of the 70 weeks. Remember, I said I wanted to teach this like the mystery of the 70 weeks for dummies. So we're going to split it up into three sections. Now, the first division is to the far left. This would be the seven sevens. So what you got to know is the 70 weeks literally means 70 sevens. 70 sevens. Are you hearing me? 70 sevens. The Hebrew word for unit of measure is Shabuah. Don't you love the sound of that? Shabuah. I feel like Tarzan. Angawa, Timba, Shabuah. Unit of measure. Get back. That's the Hebrew word for unit of measure. So listen to me. 70 sevens is a unit of measure. That would be like our dozen. So 70 sevens can be of anything. Like a dozen. I mean, I'm a farm boy. You tell me dozen, I'm thinking eggs. But it could be a dozen pencils, a dozen motorcycles. It's a unit of measure. Horses. Shabuah. Let's just end there. Timba. Angawa for you. So 77s of anything. So Jeremiah is referring to years. Remember the 70 years, sabbatical years, that would add up, if you added all those up, it adds up to 490. What's that number across the top there? 490. You can't make this stuff up. This is God. So the first division is seven sevens. It'd be just like seven times seven, for those of you with a calculator. This is 49 years. 49 years. And from the time that Nehemiah was given the decree, and I know there's others that believe it was there was three decrees to Ezra. Anyway, it's Nehemiah. Yes, thank you. Nehemiah is the one. 444 B.C. Is everybody with me? And a decree came, and from that point to that line there was set aside for the rebuilding of what? Jerusalem, the rebuilding of Jerusalem. And if you write down Nehemiah, Nehemiah, you can find this whole account in chapter 2, verse 1 through 8. Because we can't get everything in here. You've got to do some of this work yourself. And God loves self-feeding people. He loves it when we have a hunger, an insatiable hunger and thirst for the wisdom and the wealth and the knowledge of what God has for us. And God's word is shallow enough a child can play in it, and deep enough you can dive to the bottom and never find it. So this is what we're talking about. So the first division is the restoration of Jerusalem. You'll also find all these accounts in of this heading back in Esther and Nehemiah in all any of the captivity restoration books. So if we've got the first division, remember this is the 1, 2, 3 of prophecy. Do we have the first one? Nehemiah to come back and to rebuild Jerusalem, 49 years. Okay, now we can move to number two. And didn't President Bush start the No Child Left Behind? So are we all got the first one? The second one, 62 sevens. That's 62 times seven. It's pretty simple. I was better at addition than I was multiplication, but anyway. 62 times 7 is what? 434 years. So that starts at the end of the restoration period, the 49 years, and runs to the time of the Messiah. And that you'll find that in verse 25 and 26. But guess what? It ends right when the Messiah is revealed. Now this is so cool. Guys, are you excited about this? Thank you. I'll pay you later. What's exciting about this is remember during Jesus' ministry and he'd heal somebody and then he'd say, don't tell anybody. Because on Palm Sunday, he came in riding a donkey. Many, many prophecies were fulfilled by not just the donkey, but the palm branches. We sang the song Hosanna and they sang Hosanna in the highest. It means the one who saves. The Messiah has come. Remember, they looked at Jesus, says, why is everybody so crazy? And he said, if they weren't crazy, I'm paraphrasing, the rocks would cry out. This is the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ. And the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ happened exactly at the end. And Joe, you're going to love this. At the end of the 434 years on the Jewish calendar, Nisan 10. Now, if you've never heard of the Jewish calendar, it's God's calendar. You better get one. He doesn't use our calendar. Nisan 10, that's March 30th, 33 AD. And you'll find that, just write down Luke 19, verse 29 through 40. It lays out the whole thing. Now, for those of you who are going TMI because of last week, just close your ears because this is really cool. From the decree of Nehemiah to the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus Christ. Triumphal entry of Jesus Christ. 173,880 days to the minute. You can't make this stuff up. You can't make it up. So are we good on the second division? See how we're getting this? We got the first division, the restoration period. We got the second division leading up to the announcement of the Messiah when he entered Jerusalem on the donkey, when he cleared the temple. Remember all of that. This is on the Sunday. He was crucified on the Friday. Are we good with the second division? Okay. This is the thing. These two divisions were predictive prophecy under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. But you can go over here and you can look back at them. They've been fulfilled. I gave you the days. I gave you the dates. In the days. So fulfilled prophecy becomes what? History. You got to get louder. Get excited here. But our next division is eschatology. Say it with me. Eschatology. That's prophecy concerning the end of days. The end of days. The end of days. I tell you what. Can anybody say the 70 weeks of Daniel? The 70 weeks of Daniel. Come on, say it out loud. The 70 weeks of Daniel. I want you to know this. If somebody says, have you ever heard that kooky thing from Daniel? And you're going, hey, I know what it means. It's in three divisions. And the whole thing amounts to God showing up and showing off in a mighty way. So we get to this third division. This is 1-7, or 7 years. Now, are we looking at it? This is 7 years. And this is a seven-year period at the end of the age. And this where, remember at the end of the 69 weeks, the Messiah was cut off? The Messiah was cut off. He was taken. He was resurrected. He ascended to heaven. Well, at the end of the 70th week, that's the 70th week, Jesus Christ comes back bodily. I'm not talking about the rapture. I'm talking about bodily comes back. Revelation chapter 19, I mean. I think that's what you're going to read, isn't it? Hang in there. It's going to be a while. No, I'm just kidding. Oh, I know you do. That's a good thing. 70 weeks of Daniel. So there was. It said in verse 24, Daniel, get back to verse 24. It says that there are several things. There are six events that would be fulfilled at the second coming of Jesus Christ. I want to go through them because they're so awesome. It says to finish transgression, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness. Hang on, let's stop. Didn't Jesus do that on the cross? He did. He said it was finished. But it's just like our redemption. We're redeemed when we give our life to Jesus Christ. But then the fullness of it comes when Jesus comes and gets us and we get our new bodies. So the fullness of this happens when Jesus comes back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So this is to finish transgressions, to put an end to sin, to atone for wickedness. Amen. He did that, and it's going to come into its fullness. But then it says to bring everlasting righteousness. And then it says to seal up the vision in the prophecy and to anoint the Most High. To seal up the vision and the prophecy in this part of Scripture doesn't mean like Daniel sealing it up because it's concerning another time. Let me tell you, it came unsealed in 1948 when Israel became a nation overnight. And the sealing up of this is like capping an oil well. Boy, he's putting flesh down permanently. And then I love the last one, and to anoint the Most High. Anybody ever read the book of Revelation? I mean, the gals here that are going through it. Oh, let me tell you. In Revelation chapter 4 in particular, Jesus, who is worthy? Who is worthy? Who is worthy to take the scroll? This is the title deed of the earth. The title deed of the earth. And Jesus Christ has it. And he will be anointed as Most High. So I don't know about you guys, but that is awesome. That is just totally awesome. And then look at 24, at the very beginning of 24. This is an important point. You got to get it. Because the world was tainted by the covenant theologians early on and became the replacement theologians. And some of your replacement theologians were men like Adolf Hitler. So listen up. We did not replace the Jews. We were grafted in. We share in the inheritance. We did not replace them. And if you think we did, you got a rude awakening. And here in 24, he says, let me see here. The 77s are decreed for your people. Who's Daniel's people? Israel, the Jews. So the 69 weeks that we've seen as history, fulfilled prophecy, show that it was the Jews, right? Well, let me tell you, the 70th week's not going to be any different. He said, all 70 weeks are for your people and for your what? Holy city. For your city. What is that city? Jerusalem. And let me tell you, Western culture and Western, especially front page theologians, have just wanted to inject Western culture into this so much. You know, they say the Great Babylon is New York and just on and on, whatever. Hey, let me tell you, God's talking about the center of the universe, Jerusalem. We heard a Jewish historian, what was his name, Brenda? Nisam? I forget it. And anyway, yeah, it was awesome. Anybody else see that during the Taste of Israel? If we have it again next year, I want every single person here. Or bring me a slip saying you're sick. And he said, if you were an alien race, just say, and entered the universe, and entered the Milky Way, and then entered our galaxy, entered our solar system, and you were trying to find the exact center of the planet Earth, it's Jerusalem. Jerusalem. So just like realtors say, location, 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 this is the location. In the whole Mediterranean Sea, in the Fertile Crescent, this is what we're talking about. And this is where it's all going to come down. It's where it started. It's all going to come down. You wonder why Montana's not mentioned in prophecy? Because it's not in it. There's no Antichrist rising out of Chile. There might be one in Venezuela, but it's a small A. John told us in the epistles, in his epistles, that the spirit of Antichrist is present at all times. Amen. But it's not the same thing. So in 24, your people, your holy city, Jerusalem. So that doesn't concern the church. Let me tell you where the church started. Right here at the cross. Amen? And so if this all concerns the Jews, and this concerns the Jews, guess what? Our concern is right here. And I'm going to walk you through that real quick. Because the question has to come, what happens between the 69th and the 70th week? And you'll see I put on there a prophetic gap. This is the prophetic gap. The Messiah was cut off. Remember we just read. And when the time comes for God to take Israel off hold and deal with them again, we'll know it. So if I don't know if how many people here kind of hold to a pre-tribulation rapture as opposed to a mid. Anybody? I do. I wear it proud, baby. I like what Pastor Dave says, though. He says, pray for pre and prepare for post. Because, and he's just saying, hey, if I'm taken out, praise God. If I'm not, I'll willingly put my head in a guillotine for Jesus Christ. But if you are a pre-trib person, here's another bullet in your arsenal. The church is never mentioned past the church section of the book of Revelation. And it's sure not involved in the 70th week of Daniel. It pertains to the Jews once again. I just had to tell you that because it's so exciting. And Jesus in Matthew 24 talks about what happens in this prophetic gap. There are prophecies on it. Even though Daniel doesn't touch on it here, he does touch on it. I'll tell you where he touches on it, if you think he didn't. But that interval between, out of the mouth of Jesus Christ. Remember the old E.F. Hutton commercials and everybody listened up? This is out of the mouth of the Lord Jesus Christ in Matthew 24, the author and perfecter of our faith, the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the A to the Z, the one with authority over all the earth and heaven and earth and under the earth. And this is what he said. He said during this period of time, first off, he said that there would be a little A Antichrist rise up and cause a desecration of desolation. Now remember last week we were talking about Antiochus Epiphanes came out of the third kingdom, the Grecian Empire. That was 175 BC. Now we're 70 AD. And the Roman Emperor Titus, he swoops in and he destroys Jerusalem, levels it. There's nothing left of Herod's temple. And he desecrates the temple, takes everything. And Jesus said this would happen, but he also points to another time where the Antichrist will do the same thing, but in a global way. So it's another foreshadowing prophecy that Jesus gave us in Matthew 24. Also, another thing he said that happens in here, from the cross over the present church age or the age of grace, also, this is what happened. Jesus Christ became betrothed to those who accepted him as their Lord and Savior. Those of you who have been born again in this room are the bride of Christ. And this isn't a gender issue, so don't go, I'm not going to wear that white dress. It has nothing to do with that. He's the groom. Now, I'm going to try to explain this really easy, simple for you, because in Jewish customs, the groom would be betrothed to the bride. And the first thing he did, they didn't run off to Mexico or anything. You know what I'm saying? What he did is he would go to his father's house and he would do a room addition. Families did that. And then he would come get his bride when his father said it was time. Jot down on the side of your page there, John chapter 14. This is the night that Jesus drops the bomb on the disciples and says, you know what, guys, we've had a good run, but tonight I'm going to be betrayed. And tomorrow I'm going to be beaten within an inch of my life. And then I'm going to be accused of a crime I didn't commit, and then I'm going to be executed for it. And they're like, what? And then he says, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are what? Many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you. Are you with me? The groom's going to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, I will come back and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And that was King James, baby. God has this amazing plan. So that's the other thing in this prophetic gap, is the bride is being gathered. Now, there's no other place that you can be the bride of Christ. The martyrs of the tribulation or tribulation martyrs, and on and on and on. You're the bride of Christ during the age of grace. Now, Jesus also said that it would be like in the days of Noah. And one of the things I like to look at there is that Noah preached for how many years, Joe? 120 years. Don't give up is the message there. Don't give up, because nobody was listening. But the ark door was opened. During this prophetic gap, this church age, this age of grace, the ark door is open. Grace is available. If you're alive, if you can hear my voice, if you're listening to me in Uganda, wherever you're at, we've got friends all over the world. If you hear me, grace is available. Grace is available for you by simply yielding your heart and surrendering yourself to Christ. Then you become the bride. And then when all hell breaks loose, you'll be having a marriage supper of the Lamb while it's happening. Oh, let me tell you, we talked about it in worship practice. Marriage supper of the Lamb. And when you push back from that banquet table, Jesus is going to say, mount up. Yeah, we're riding. The biggest, most powerful trail ride in history. And I'm not going to go there yet. I'm just whetting your appetite. Look at verse 26. I told you Daniel speaks of this foreshadowing of the desecration of desolation too. He says, the people of the prince shall come. And this refers to the 70 AD destruction by the Roman Emperor Titus. But then it also says that the prince shall come. You know why? This is a foreshadowing. It's a foreshadowing. And if you know how God does this, it's exciting. He foreshadows an event that's a local event, pointing to a future event that's global. Little Antichrist, big Antichrist. Little horn, little big horn? No, that's the custard thing again. I said I wouldn't go there. So as we're looking in the church age, what else could happen there? We've seen the destruction of Jerusalem, 70 AD. That's fulfilled prophecy slash history. We know the church is being built. Jesus said there would be wars and rumors of wars. He said it'll be like a woman giving birth with contractions getting stronger and closer, leading up to the time where his kingdom is birthed. But also, he said, Jesus himself, remember, E.F. Hutton's nothing compared to Jesus. He said, Israel will be rebirthed. And he says, when you see the budding of the fig tree, when you see it, wake up. Wake up. Well, church, we are awake. Is anybody sleeping on this one? We live in the end of the age. We're seeing signs that are eschatological. That's easy for me to say. Wish I hadn't tried that. Makes me look stupid. No. We're seeing things that are in the end of the age, prophecies being fulfilled. Amen? And other things you want to keep your eyes for, not just that Israel was birthed overnight in 1948, the control of Jerusalem, was what, 1967, 68? The return of Jews coming just daily out of Europe? We're seeing things, guys. We're seeing it. This is exciting. Other things you might look for, we know there's going to be a 10-nation confederation. Remember Nebuchadnezzar's statue with 10 toes, or Daniel's vision of the beast, a nondescript beast with the 10 horns. In Revelation chapter 13, how many women are here are going through the book of Revelation? Well, I'm going through it too. That's why I feel like I'm on steroids here. I'm doing both. In Revelation chapter 13, he sees a beast rise out. It looks like a lion. It looks like a leopard. It looks like a bear. It's got 7 heads and 10 horns. It's Daniel chapter 7. God doesn't miss anything. You can't make this stuff up. It's awesome. So we could be looking for a 10-nation confederation. You know, people for a long time, guys who've been in prophecy in the room, I know, have looked at the revised Roman Empire, the European Economic Community. You know, we've looked at a lot of things. One time I saw, and I talked to Timothy about it, I like to look at planning maps, like, where off-ramps are going to be in the future. You know, like where Smart Road is, hits 50 Highway, you know how dangerous that is? They're going to put it together with an overpass and have a movie theater on the northeast corner. And it's just like, I like that kind of stuff. But I got to see a planning map of the world. Guess what? They're going to break the world up. This is long-range planning into 10 sections. And remember the North American Free Trade Agreement that Bill Clinton got us into? Then you love him. Canada, United States, and Mexico, that's one section. And they've even got the money system named, the Amero. So I don't know how it's going to come down, but you could be looking for that. I wouldn't waste your time too much because we need to be witnessing. But it's cool. It's fun. Also, there's going to be the book of Revelation, once you're past, for you gals that are doing it, once you're past Jesus talking to the 7 churches, then it runs simultaneously with the 7 weeks. You are in the tribulation period. It's called the 70th week of Daniel. Say it with me. 70th week of Daniel. It's called the tribulation period. Say it. The tribulation period. Jeremiah called it the time of Jacob's trouble. That's Jacob as in Israel. This is a specific time set aside. But guess what? It's going to be the Antichrist is going to be revealed, but he won't be the guy in a red suit with the horns. He's going to be an attractive, charismatic leader. Remember, if you've ever read Revelation, the riders of the apocalypse, and the first one's on a white horse. He's counterfeit. He's trying to mirror Revelation chapter 19. And he's got a crown. But guess what? He has a bow with no arrows. It means he's going to conquer diplomatically. He's going to gather. Remember the 10 horns and 3 were plucked up. 3 didn't agree. This is really cool stuff. And he's going to set a peace treaty, guess what, for 7 years. And the Quran says their coming Messiah, named the Mahdi, is going to make a peace treaty with Israel for 7 years. And the Mahdi rides a white horse. You can't make this stuff up. It's coming down the pike. Are we ready? Are we ready as a people, as a church? And it's all going to be fun and games. It's going to be unification. It's going to be getting things together. But then in the middle of this 7-week period, the Antichrist breaks in. We read that right at the end of our reading in Daniel. And he will come in and he will break the treaty. He will break it. He not only will break it. Remember all the foreshadowing prophecies we've been reading about. The desolation of desecration prophecies. This is the ultimate. He not only breaks it, he enters Palestine, takes over. He'll make the third temple his capital. He will set up an image of gold. Does that sound like Daniel chapter 3? Except he'll make the world worship it, not just the people living around the old Baghdad area. This is the Antichrist. And this will continue for 3.5 years, the last 3.5 years, or 2,300 days, or 42 months. If you didn't take a picture of this, I want you to get it before the night's over. And during that time, all hell will break loose. I want us to close our eyes for a moment. I know it's been a lot of information. And I know I'm excited like a squirrel on crack. But you got to know my real heart is I want that no one goes to hell. That's the heart of God. God wants that no one goes to hell. And I want the same thing. So as we look at these tremendous prophecies that we can see fulfilled down to the day, down to the minute, with dates and times, it's so that a non-believer will go, hey, maybe this God is who he says he is. Maybe this God is God. Maybe he really is in control. Maybe he really is who he says he is. Maybe he really has it going on. And I'm here to tell you, it's all of the above. And what I want to present to anyone who's never trusted in Jesus Christ, what are you waiting for? You have everything to gain, and you have nothing to lose except sorrow, brokenness. And everything is ahead of you is that God says he'll lift you up on wings of eagles. He wants to lift you up as the bride of Christ. He wants to fill you with his spirit. And he wants these things we've been talking about to make sense because all of a sudden it's being interpreted by the Holy Spirit, not just you trying to hang on to the horn. And so, this is how simple it is. If that's you, just where you're sitting, just say this from your heart. Lord Jesus, you know, I've run from you my whole life. Lord, I've read every self-help book that was in the library. And I realize now you're the only help. And you're the only hope. And you're the only one who can deliver me through those gates, the pearly gates. And Lord, I know that you are the way and the truth and the life, just like your word says. And I want to yield myself with a broken, contrite spirit, Lord. I want to humble myself and get down so you can raise me up. And I will live forever. And Lord, I believe in your death, your burial, your resurrection, all the stuff we hear about. Lord, I'm with you. I got it. I just want to be a part of the winning team. I see how this ends. And I want to be on the winning team. In Jesus' name. Let's keep our eyes down. If there's anyone who prayed that with me from their heart, just make eye contact with me. You don't have to raise a hand. God bless you. Anybody over here, just look at me. Just as a witness, as a testimony. God bless you. Is there anyone else? Okay, for the rest of you, you know, that insatiable hunger and thirst for the wisdom and the wealth and the knowledge of God. Isn't it awesome? I just want to pray over you for your growth, for spiritual protection. And for those who made decisions here tonight, Lord, put your wing over them like a hen puts it over her chicks. And let the body of Christ come around. There's safety in numbers. And we need to have each other's back. And Lord, I just ask all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Hey, if you did accept Christ or you got anything to talk about, come see us. Well, I want to give you information. I want to walk it out with you because I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Most of you are going, amen. I knew him on the other side. I'm a sinner saved by grace. But greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And I know that I'm nothing without Jesus Christ. Nothing. I was nothing before and I'm nothing now, but with Jesus I'm something. He's given me a new lease on life. He's, matter of fact, he's given me eternal life. Doesn't get any better than that. Hey, I can't leave us right here. I've got a bonus reader. We ended at the end of that chapter with the Antichrist getting what he deserved, right? Now, this is read out right here in Revelation chapter 19, verse 11 through 16. So go ahead and get there if you got your Bibles. Now, this is also the image of the beast, of the statue of Nebuchadnezzar, when the stone that was not cut from human hands comes crashing in. Same time period. His kingdom comes in. And Joel, I want you to read. Is everybody there? Okay, brother. Read it nice and slow and from the heart. And
for
let this soak
who,
in.
Who
we
doesn't
win.
Know by now, I am Joe.
He's Joe.
And I cannot I cannot read this sitting down because I'm excited. Revelations 19:11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse, and he who sat on it is called faithful and true. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire. And on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written on him which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood. And his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses. And from his mouth comes a sharp sword, so that with it he may strike down the nations, and he will rule them with a rod of iron. And he treads the winepress of the fierce wrath of God the Almighty. And on his robe and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords.
Let's stand.